In this layer for side video, we'll look at the TMS alcohol protecting group, including the reaction and mechanism. So you're looking to carry out this chain elongation with an alkyne in the product, or this elongation, where we also turn the aldehyde into an alcohol, it seems straightforward enough. For the first reaction, we simply add this alkynide for an SN2 reaction, and here we just add a Grignard followed by an acid, right? Not quite. These reagents would work if we didn't have the alcohol present. The problem is that alcohol is acidic because of the polar covalent bond between oxygen and hydrogen. Oxygen is partially negative and hydrogen is partially positive. And therefore, in the presence of a strong base like the alkynide or the Grignard, the base is going to attack the hydrogen rather than anything else on the molecule, deprotonating the alcohol, destroying the reagent, and making sure that our reaction does not proceed the way we want. So how do you carry out this reaction? Very simple. If alcohol's proton is the distraction, get rid of the proton, make it unreactive, then the base is forced to attack the other portion of the molecule to give us the reaction we want. As an example, I love browsing Instagram. And even though my phone is always silent, if I see the notification, I want to click it. So what do? I just cover my phone. Can't see the notification, not distracted. And then when I want to browse Instagram, I uncover my phone, I see the notifications, and I'm good to browse. We said that alcohol is a distraction because the partially negative oxygen is bound to a partially positive hydrogen, and the base will attack the hydrogen. But if we look at an ether, which is very similar, we have the R group bound to a partially negative oxygen, but the oxygen doesn't have a hydrogen, it has another R group. And even though the oxygen is partially negative, this R group is not positive enough to be attacked by a strong base, and therefore not distracting enough to derail our reaction. In fact, haven't we already seen an ether protecting group when we looked at acetal formation with carbonyl reactions? In this reaction, we're going to create a silyl ether, which instead of ROR using carbon, will have an oxygen bound to a silicon atom. Silicon is bigger, it's a more effective protecting group, and it's easily removed with a fluoride ion or an acid. The two reagents to know are TMS, trimethyl silyl, in this case chloride, which looks like this. A silicon atom in the middle, the trimethyl, three methyl groups around it, and chlorine as a leaving group to initiate the reaction. And so in reactions, you'll see it written as TMS-Cl. And the second reagent, TBAF, or tetrabutyl ammonium fluoride, is a source of fluoride ions with a countercation. This molecule has a central nitrogen with four butyl groups giving it a positive charge and a counteranion, F-. You'll also see this written as Bu4 for the butyls, N plus F minus. Ready to see it in action? Let's go back to our Grignard reaction and recognize that the first thing we have to do is protect the alcohol. Forget the Grignard for a moment and let's first react it with TMSCl. The mechanism isn't clearly known for this, but it's presumed to follow an SN2 style reaction where the alcohol attacks the silicon. Yes, it's tertiary, which wouldn't happen with carbon, but silicon is a bigger atom, and it's presumed to happen one step at a time, where after this is attacked, chlorine gets kicked out. This gives us our starting molecule, which still has the hydrogen atom with one lone pair and a positive charge, because the other electrons are now bound to the silicon, which still has the three methyl groups. This reaction takes place in a weak base like ET3N, which is going to come in and grab that proton off of the oxygen, giving it back its electrons and making it neutral. For a molecule that no longer looks like an alcohol because we have this funky ether going on. Now that there's no proton to distract, we can finally bring in the Grignard, which will attack the carbonyl carbon, kicking those pi electrons up to the oxygen to give us an O-. That is step one. In step two, we protonate so that O- becomes an OH. It's okay to form the OH here because the Grignard is done. This gives us an OH where the carbonyl used to be, and a new bond between the carbonyl carbon and the incoming Grignard carbon atoms. Now all we have to do is remove that protecting group, which is very simple. We bring in our TBAF, which is the source of fluoride ions, a mechanism that you very likely don't have to know, and simply recognize that fluoride will kick this group out and reform the alcohol, finally giving us the product that we expected from the beginning. If your professor requires you to know and draw every single molecule, this is what you have to do. Most professors, however, will let you show a simplified version as follows. You have your starting molecule and you know you need to protect the alcohol. Simply react it with TMSCl. This right here is our trimethylsilyl group with a chlorine. Show the oxygen attacking TMS and kicking out the Cl. In fact, you can take it a step further by showing that it reacts in ET3N. Put minus H plus over here to show that the H plus was removed. And you can go right to the protected ether, showing oxygen bound to TMS for the OTMS group. Now you're free to carry out your reaction. So bring in your Grignard for step one and show that step two, you protonate the O minus with water. The Grignard attacks the carbonyl. You kick up those electrons. That O minus ultimately reaches for an H plus, which you may or may not have to show. Make sure you know what your professor is looking for to give us the following. The carbonyl oxygen is now a hydroxy group, and we have a new bond to those two incoming Grignard carbons. Finally, in the last step, you simply write TBAF to show that we're using the tetrabutyl ammonium fluoride to remove the TMS to give you your final product with the alcohol reformed and the incoming Grignard exactly where you want it to be with no side reactions. Regardless of which method you follow, I want you to recognize the pattern here of a 1-2-3 reaction. Step one, we protect the alcohol. Step two, we react the rest of the molecule. And step three, we deprotect to reform the alcohol. Are you ready to apply this to the other example? If yes, first, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and hit that bell icon so you don't miss out on any new videos. Then pause this video, give it a try, and see if we came up with the same answer. Is this what you got? For even more on alcohols, from physical properties to reactions and mechanism, a practice quiz and cheat sheet, see the link below or visit my website, layerforsci.com/alcohol. Again, that's layerforsci.com/alcohol.